Imagine for a second that you are a public parks administrator overseeing the redesign of a large urban park. Nobody knows the complexity of this task better than you do. There is complicated hydrology and topography to deal with, degraded landscapes that need to be restored and made more climate resilient. You want to keep it as carbon neutral as possible with natural materials or even found on site, and you want the public to be properly engaged. You imagine this probably takes months worth of work to get to, just for the planning and visioning part of it. And that's what most teams are telling you. Highly detailed site inventory and analysis, 3D models built over time with GIS and all of these lovely little doodads, and then visioning two community meetings, and then iterative designs, and then back to another community meeting, and so on. And then you have one design team show up with remarkably few landscape architects, and they come up to you and say, we're going to do all of those things, but on the order of weeks instead of months, as far as our available time put towards it. And with the same quality, perhaps greater. And incredulously, you take one of them aside afterwards, and you're like, are you serious? You really think this? And they say, yeah, as a matter of fact, yes. And using this thing called artificial intelligence, to be honest, I might not even be involved in a lot of the process. I'll just be pushing buttons. How does that make you feel? Excited? Me too. Could be lots of interesting savings and thoughts on projects. Does it make you nervous? Maybe disturbed? Me too. There's a lot to be handled about this. And if you have been paying attention over the timeline of my fellowship, most of these developments have happened over just that 1 year timeline. And every element of the process that I've put forward with you, even though they are not seamlessly put together into one right now, each individually has capabilities with AI right now. And it has provoked feelings and thoughts. Some of our philosophers are saying we have summoned an alien intelligence who is going to take over our minds. Some of the detractors in the same field say, you need to not listen to them because we are making advancements in healthcare, in all sorts of fields that will help people. This is, and also you can't stop it. There's no reason to. Which side of that camp do you fall on? What do you think? Well, what I've been able to see is that there's a little bit of both. And in my research over the past year, I think that AI will bolster, break, and transform the processes of landscape architecture. And I want to tell you a little bit about how I've come to that conclusion. First, let's get a baseline. What is this? We hear this word all the time. What is it really? Well, thinking about human and non-human intelligences is actually as old as humanity itself. We've been really thinking about thinking for as long as we've thought. But the term itself is a little newer. In the 1950s, and you can tell for multiple reasons, this was in the 1950s by looking at that picture, and some people came together and said, computer science and technology and engineering are not quite getting this new emergent thing, which is advances in computation that are helping us basically do human things that are take our thinking, but they are quite tedious, but do them better and do them faster. And they thought, we should come up with a term for this. They thought about all these different ones. Complex information processing was the front runner. And they thought, maybe that's not sexy enough. Can I say that on live stream? But they said, artificial intelligence probably makes more sense. And there we have it, an interesting marketing gimmick for those in Hollywood that typically make us think, okay, if machines are thinking, they must be supplanting humanity immediately. It's not exactly so. While this is a part of artificial intelligence theory, what this really is reflecting is something called artificial general intelligence, which is when machines get to the point where they have awareness, like humans do. But most of what we deal with, while this is an important part of it, the more important is in artificial narrow intelligence, which is most of what you deal with on a daily basis. Think your Amazon Echo, a self-driving car, a Pinterest board. These are all part of artificial narrow intelligence that is specifically formed for tasks and or a multitude of tasks that are narrow in scope and within only that scope. Now, and you can think of each of these elements as making up a part of a greater system of AI, but the entity itself is not exactly AI, but rather part of an intricate network of fields and subfields within what we call the umbrella of artificial intelligence. So one of these applications is rather a nesting of a subfield of AI, which is then part of the greater field of AI. So rule of thumb there, it's more a theory and a process than it is a thing. And it has various subfields and subsets, and most of what we do is interacting in a narrow sense. But there also is an important indicator, which is learning and thinking. It's not just simply crunching and crunching and crunching. There's more going on there. And we'll get into some examples about that. Now, this AI has been used in the AEC industry for actually quite some time now. And it's also in landscape architecture, what I've been able to find. I was curious about this. Are we doing anything with it? Because it seems like not. But in fact, AI has pervaded just about every part of the design process in some way. Anything from conceptual urban design being done online to visualizations and concepts to autonomously constructing landscape with found materials in situ in real time, including the design. And AI has been researched for more than a decade, though that growth has been more exponential in the past few years. But that's all fine and good, Phil, but how does it actually work? Well, let's take an example of a very popular one lately called ChatGPT. I want to come up with a manifesto that puts together the thoughts of all of the greatest leaders that we know in landscape architecture, or some of them, I should say. We'll just go with some. And say, what does it look like if they get together in a room and say, what does the future look like? It looks kind of interesting. And it looks kind of believable. And, a little odd and scary, almost magical. Well, okay, that's fine. We can play around with words as much as we want. But what does it do if I try to do something visually? Well, let's say that I've been calculating all my time with Chris Hardy's Cowabing Neutral Calculator, and I've got all of the things there, but I just need a visualization, just real quick, to show my client what it might look like. I put in all my indicators, my materials, what I think it should be, and it's an urban plaza, something like along those lines. This might take me 6 billable hours to get that rendering together, or it might take me a minute. Not bad. Not bad. And again, it kind of makes you a little uncomfortable. You're like, what is this? Well, it's not as magical as you think. What actually happens is your prompt gets tokenized. Each individual word gets put into an array of numbers. Those numbers then get fed into what we would say is a rule book, basically, how things need to be predicted within the text. And then it goes in, say a search of every single thing ever been written, and says, what's the next most probable thing or word after that word? And there you go. Pretty good guesses. The same thing is actually happening in text to image as well. It does the same with pixels. This is part of something mostly called machine learning, which is the way of patterning data. We teach a machine to either structure data for us, use the structure we've already given it to just do things faster, or to be adaptable in real time and maybe try and teach us something new. And every single pixel is on the internet in a picture or a piece of art is the same way. You can tie it to something, to a concept. So this is actually really interesting, and it can bolster what we're doing. AI has many potential for landscape architecture, I believe. Let's go through a couple of them. In the more mundane sense, anyone who's been an entry-level designer in the age of Photoshop knows the task of going over through the internet, browsing for PNGs that I can put together in a rendering. Maybe it's behind a paywall, maybe you don't have the species you need, something like that. Well, using one of these generative AI applications, you can get that image and maybe all of the plants that you're using in an entire asset library and with variations of it, rather than just like turning the thing and thinking it looks like it's natural. And then put it together in your renderings later. Very interesting task, can probably save even up to 90% of time. That's great. Then we can spend more time on what actually matters about design. But it's not just about efficiencies. There's also things at the crossroads of complex issues like equity, climate change, biodiversity. Take the indigenous traditional owners in the Nari Nari tribe in New South Wales and Australia, who 20 years ago were given what was essentially a dust bowl of their former lands and have tried to reintroduce wetlands and restore the land, but also make it climate resilient. They're now partnering with an AI company to better know how to manage their immense amount of land, 80,000 hectares, but also be able to reintroduce some of their traditional ways of managing the land, such as cultural burning. And it is immensely helpful to them, and they have found it to be really a boon to what they're doing, because with so few of them and so much land, it's actually a lot harder to understand how it can be successful. It can even bolster some of the things we've seen today, such as the carbon conscience calculator, or Erin even said that there will be machine learning implemented into her tool to help us with our vacant land atlas. But there's also things that might break down about what we think landscape architecture is. If AI can do things like jam with jazz musicians, create paintings autonomously, or talk to spiders, and then it can also produce images that we would normally produce with a lot of hour and emotional heft put into it, what does that actually mean about what we do? Landscape architect Jeff Cutler, who is the principal of Space to Place, said this is one of the first things that truly surprised me, and I think it changes a lot of what we think creativity is. In a couple of different ways. When we look at that, it doesn't matter who produced it, a student, a principal, can we actually figure out if they truly understand that process, the critical thinking that goes into design? Is it about the product of making a pretty picture, or is it about what's behind it? This is a big question. And what happens is we get shown ourselves in the mirror and we say, what am I actually? What is it that I really do? Because sometimes the way that we market ourselves to potential clients or to others may seem a little different than what is actually most valuable about what we do. The economic theory of creative destruction basically says, as any new innovation or technology comes along and is available to the masses, it then makes the older methods and technologies become irrelevant and fall out. The same thing can happen in landscape architecture, I believe. As these things are now available to the masses and people can leverage them, we might have to rethink what some of these things are. It's not a full break necessarily. It's not AI is going to take our job. But it may be that somebody knows how to leverage AI could make you rethink what you do in your job and how you spend your time. There's also ethical issues to be taken into account. AI has a tie to something. There may be intellectual property behind it. There may be natural resources being used to go into the big data centers that are made going into your computation and human labor. And then there's also just things about what is right to do when we are producing things with AI. And that's where we may need to take a step back, look at the fundamentals of what we do, and say, how do we transform the profession to be ready for this, to be adaptable to it? I think we need to reassess what creativity is. I think we need to reassess business practices, labor, maybe. We need to understand what AI functions are. We need to understand data, how it's put together, and how we source it. And we need to really clarify what our core values are. What do we think it is most valuable what we do? And it may seem like a silly question to everyone in this room, but it's not to those who are outside of us and those who are using AI every day already and say, wait, so what is it that you do? I think we need to have a meeting of the minds. And I want to call on any professional organization, any individual, anybody who thinks landscape architecture should remain relevant, to get together. Let's make an organizational network. Let's make standards of practice. Let's make educational resources. In fact, our allied professions are already a little bit ahead of us on this. APA and AIA, amongst others, real estate and construction, have already made white papers about the issue and have working groups. People should get involved in something that I'm going to be, in things like the thing I'm going to be involved with the next few months, which is the Built Environment Futures Council, an interdisciplinary group for real estate, engineering, construction, landscape architecture. And as we do this, we can figure out what it is that we need to imbue of our value system into the advancement of these technologies, because they are going to advance, they are going to be used, they're being used by our students, by our practitioners, and we need to figure out how we can bring our future lovingly into being. So if you want to join me, please. I want to join you. Let's get together. Thank you.